Hey guys, I'm gonna attempt to do, this is about a 50 minute long video. I'm gonna do a voiceover. So we're testing it out and it seems to work. Got the original volume turned down. This is a jiu-jitsu training session. I posted some footage of this a couple weeks ago. This is the full training session. It was about 50 minutes long. Gracie wants to join in. She enters the mat, tries to go for some takedowns on both of us. Right here, I'm teaching my oldest daughter exactly how to do the cross-collar choke. I'll be putting a video up explaining this choke specifically and some other moves specifically, breaking them down, how to do it. Right here, I'm showing her how to grab and with which part of the forearm and wrist. Our forearms are rectangular, so it's really important to understand how to apply this choke and close the space up. I see a lot of people do this wrong, get taught wrong and teach it wrong, and they simply give up on it. It's an extremely effective move, great for self-defense. If anybody is wearing a jacket, you can apply this choke pretty easily. It also helps to block punches while applying this choke with your flaring of your elbows. Explaining to her right here the importance of remembering which way to go. If I go in with the first hand, palm up, if I'm gonna go under my original arm, I have to go palm up as well. If I was gonna go over, I would go palm down to the opposite shoulder. Here, I'm just intensely explaining to her how important details are. It's one of the things that can either make or break people in jiu-jitsu. Some people like formulaic things, things that require step-by-step and they get the same results every time, kind of like math. Jiu-jitsu is kind of the same way. You know, if you were supposed to add 3 plus 3, but you multiplied 3 times 3, your answer is still correct, but you did the wrong thing, you know? So it's, I don't know if that makes sense, but anyways. So here, heavy focus on the detail, explaining to her that we're just turning our palms up. Turning our palms up after we tighten up, that changes the orientation of the wrist. Basically, when you're completely tight and then you're using the top part of the forearm on both sides, when you turn your wrist up, you're gonna basically close the space by about 3 inches total. That's putting the pressure right on the carotid artery of the neck. Very little pressure, or you can go super hard with strength when you apply something. Just depends on, you know, how hard people want to train. Obviously, we're not going to go hard with my daughter here, but the, you know, if you were applying this choke in a self-defense situation, you could apply it really hard and the person would become unconscious, and then you would, if you're trained properly, you'd know the moment that they lose consciousness, you'd be looking for that, you would let go of the choke and get away, things like that, you know. Self-preservation, always try to avoid a fight, always. Just every fight I've ever been in, I've regretted being in it, you know, no matter the outcome. There was a time where I used my years of training incorrectly, and I learned from that. There was somebody actually walking in front of my house across the street where there's actually a school. At the time, it was a different type of school, and quite a few young kids there. This person, this man, pulled out a gun and started pointing it everywhere and pointing it at the school and pretending to shoot it and walking down the street. I should have not intervened at all. That's where self-preservation comes in. Luckily, I was able to be fine and survive this situation. It turned out the gentleman was, I shouldn't call him a gentleman, we should call him an idiot, but he was carrying a BB gun. So it was silver. When all the cops showed up and everything, they freaked out over it. No, we didn't know it was a BB gun at the time. Still though, you're not allowed to walk down and point the street pointing a BB gun with no orange caps, completely silver, made to look exactly like a Beretta replica. And I ran across the street, four lanes of traffic. As soon as he passed my house, he was pointing the gun. I grabbed around both his arms, grabbed the gun, pointing it away from both of us, tripped him to the ground all at the same time, disarming and throwing the gun away from us as we fell the opposite way. Looking back, I should have never got involved. The person immediately didn't fight. It's like they almost knew why someone might tackle them. They just got freaked out. Small struggle. I was on my side with back control. And, you know, when you get in an actual altercation like that, you just immediately set in. I was like, what if he has weapons? All these things. It was not as easy to get my bottom leg out from underneath him and come up to my knees and get full mount or get back mount from a top position. There was, even though I had years and years of training and specifically the self-defense aspects, you know, I look at this differently now. And it's always about preserving yourself, preserving others. There's no time where being a hero is gonna overshadow, you know. In the end, it was just a BB gun. Nobody would have really been hurt. I didn't press charges. Thank God the person didn't press charges against me for tackling them. But after a moment there on the ground, I composed myself, started doing my jiu-jitsu as tight as I could, controlling them, and then got them in a full mount position, full back mount position. And then the person begged me to let them go. Undercover detective heard people who were calling 911 in the area about what I was waving people down to call 911. And what happened is an undercover detective heard it on their transmission radio, and then they stopped. They were in the neighborhood. He came up super professional. He said, "Hey, I'm undercover. What's going on?" He could tell I was in complete control, not punching this guy, and I didn't throw a single punch. And he says, "What's going on?" I pointed to the gun. Some other people had stopped, and some idiot picked the gun up, really bad gun safety, was pointing it in all the wrong directions and got immediately extremely yelled at by the detective. Hold on just a second, guys. I had to turn my oven timer off. And so that he's like, "Put it down!" You know, so that shows the extremity. Nobody knew this gun was a BB gun at the time. Gun safety, man. I meet people every day who own guns and have CCWs and, "Oh, let me show you." Not every day, I don't meet anybody, but everybody who's like, "Can I show you my gun or this or that?" Worst gun safety ever. Pointing it everywhere. You never point a gun in any direction that's unsafe. You always assume a gun's loaded. It just blows me away. So many people for gun rights, for the Second Amendment, have horrible gun safety. It's just crazy. it's something that you should be taught really young, and just, God, there's just no room for error. But anyways, so the guy detective stops, and he gets his handcuffs out. I basically control the guy so the guy can easily cuff him. I do it a certain way. And then I remember the detective was like, are you a cop? Or like, he was like, who are you, you know? And I was like, I just have trained jiu-jitsu for, at the time, over 10 years. And I'd say that to him. And he's just like, oh, okay. And anyway, so I let him take over. I run across the street. I go inside. I tell my wife what just happened. And then, obviously, for months, you know, I learned a lesson from this. I think a lot of people might have told this story to everyone and how they're a hero or something or cool. To me, I should have never intervened. It was actually my old neighbor, 80-some-year-old man, I'm really good friends with, and he told me I shouldn't have intervened. It just didn't matter, you know, like, it's, you know, I did have the skill set to do that and stuff, but had something gone wrong and had I got stabbed or it been a real gun and I couldn't have taken it away and I had gotten shot, I would have been me who initiated that, like, transaction. And I take that lesson with me, and it's something I knew before. You always avoid a fight. You always avoid an altercation, you know. In my head at the time, I feared calling police immediately would result in, like, this young person getting shot to death. I made the decisions I'd made, and that's what happened. They took him off to jail. They wanted to get my statement. I wanted to remain anonymous. They couldn't take my statement anonymously, they claimed. A couple of the cops thought I did a great job. You know, I think in hindsight, my 2020 vision is I would have never done that ever again. Some of the cops, well, just one of the cops was just thought that, oh, it was a BB gun, it's not a real gun. And I'm like, okay, you know, my idea is, anything can be a weapon, you know. It's the use of the item. So your gun could jam and you could use it like a hammer and hit someone in the head with it. Kind of a concept, you know. Anyways, that was the story time. So right here, we're going over side control. And I didn't know I was going to tell that story right now. So that's a little treat for anybody else who just heard that. That's something private that happened to me. Showing her the importance of getting your correct positioning with your solar plex, where to put your hip, how to have your elbow to pinch the body, and where to put your hand. I see a lot of people do this incorrectly. I like to have my hand straight out. It really makes quite a difference if they try to push you over in that direction. It gives you a base in that direction. Then I'm just explaining to her how heavy you can be and how to shear your weight through someone. Pulling up on how to grab the arm on that side. And I want the underhook on my right side. So I'm going to pinch her hand underneath my left armpit. And then my left hand is going to go not just pinch her elbow, but it's behind her elbow. So every time she moves her hand or her elbow to the mat, my hand will stay there under her elbow, and I can always get that back. Now I'm going to explain to her the importance when someone goes to get the guard back, you have to switch your hips. If they're getting their guard back, you face their legs. It's super important. So I show her right here. We're going to work on side control escape. She's going to understand how to keep her base with her left foot so I don't keep turning her back to her flat back. Explaining if you get up on your toes, it's like way more weight on the person. And she's a champ right here, because I know I crushed her a little bit. My beard's usually not this big. I'll let it get kind of fluffy at least once a year. And it was funny, someone left a really stupid comment on one of my other videos, like, about, you know, like if I can't shave or something. I thought it was really funny. Okay, right here, she's working on this. Now she's gonna grip my hand under her armpit and grab the back of my elbow. She could be gripping my hand. If you grip the hand under the armpit, it's a lot better. I have my hand a little deeper than for her to do that, but that's what's nice about having the footage nowadays. It makes it really easy to see your mistakes. Giving her a little bit of weight, off balancing her with my weight of my legs, so she can feel how to control the position, how to adjust her weight and keep someone pinned. Super important thing that I notice a lot of people, I don't understand what it is with the sports jiu-jitsu, but a ton of people can't pin people anymore. Wrestling has become really popular finally in jiu-jitsu, which is good, because the way I've always looked at it is once you truly understand leverage and mechanics and using least amount of effort and stuff to reserve your energy and gain a maximum result, once you understand those and you train jiu-jitsu for a long time, in my opinion, it's really easy to discern what would work in a fight when there's strikes involved. I don't know what it is about some practitioners, but they just aren't willing to understand a move can come from a different art. It can come from judo, wrestling, Mongolian box, Shaozhou. It can come, there's everything, you know. Striking is a big part of the training, and if it works, if it's effective, and if it's effective in, if you do sports jiu-jitsu, it's going to be effective in sports jiu-jitsu, but if you do it for self-defense, if it's effective in an area where there's striking involved, if it's effective, you know, in the street, apply it to your training. It just blows me away. But like wrestling, and being able to pin somebody and hold them down and transition, that's something that I would think is a little more popular now that people are so willing to learn wrestling and takedowns, something that just kind of lacked in the jiu-jitsu community for many, many years. Everything just comes full circle. But takedowns, I see a lot of people learn them now, and then you can take someone down effectively. But then because of the sport jiu-jitsu, I see what happens is they're just not, they don't want to pin the person and control the person. Which when someone's really good at that, you'll see that that prevails a lot of times. So people will just think, oh, I'll hit a submission from, I'll learn submissions from every single spot, every bad spot. You know, we have like the buggy choke now, which is when you're stuck in a bad position, you can get a submission. In a street fight, I've seen in the competition, the people get slammed on their head 3-4 times and still finish the buggy choke. But no, like, and you see it all the time in competition. Someone will get picked up, just absolutely slammed, but then land in a, then get a, the person who got slammed gets like a triangle choke from the bottom. It's like in a street fight, that's not going to happen. That first initial slam, you're going to be done. You're going to pretend, you'll probably die or have brain damage for the rest of your life, and you're not going to throw a triangle. Same thing with the buggy choke. You try to do a buggy choke in the street, and anybody is going to fucking smack your head around on the ground instinctually. Something people don't understand as well with street fighting is when you're fighting someone who has no idea what they're doing. So I could know all the best jiu-jitsu and be better than them. I noticed this when I would train with new people in the gym. They would do everything. And then so they would go nonstop, do anything they can. And now when someone fights that way, when they smother you with offense, you still have to defend every single thing they're doing, counter it. You have to answer it. Some people don't train for that, I noticed. Some of the hardest fights, you know, are going to be against an untrained person, you know. A trained person isn't going to make mistakes. You're going to be on the same page and, you know, but an untrained person is still going to go for a headlock, you know. And even though you know a headlock escape, they're going to go for it. You have to do the headlock escape. You have to learn it and things like that. You know, it's just something I see people not understand. And, you know, if you go to break someone's arm in the street, you know, they're going to have a natural reaction where, you know, if you hurt someone enough, too much almost, it's kind of like when idiots say, oh, I could fight, I'll just see red. Well, what that all comes from is seeing red is something that you can't just see and get this, you know, extra power or something. But there is a fight or flight response that can be induced in all humans. It's an instinctual genetic thing. If you beat someone hard enough, you know, they'll have the ability to jump higher than normal, for example. They might be able to run away and jump over a fence they could never jump over if someone was challenging them to jump that high, to give an example. I hope this is making sense. If I'm in the street fight and I'm just absolutely going hard on someone, instead of just controlling them and getting them to pass out or something, you might induce their ability to see red per se, and they might go into a fight or flight response where they wiggle and squirm so hard that it might be like nothing you've ever experienced controlling someone who's trained before. Someone who's trained before might be calm on the bottom. And although you have years of training and know what to do when someone is bucking from the bottom or turning or try to wiggle and squirm, you know, it's just something I don't see a lot of people talk about, but you don't want to induce that in an untrained person. So it's really important that you avoid a fight, and less is always more. If, you know, I'm backed into a corner, for example, hands up, clinch, you know, make sure we move out of the corner and disengage immediately. We don't need to take down and all the way to choke. We need to get away. So you might clinch someone to get out of a corner and then say, oh, I'm going to take this guy down, teach him a lesson and all this and choke him out. And then during that process where you could have actually just disengaged and gotten away and completely control the distance and restart the fight over and over until you can get away safely. Instead of getting away, you go, oh, I'm going to go for this takedown and go for the choke. Like I said, that might be the moments they're able to pull out a knife, or their friend or some bystander doesn't know who's in the right or the wrong, and they come by and they stab you or they kick you, or maybe someone pulls a firearm out and they go, both of you stop, and they're pointing it at you and the gun goes off, you know? Like, those are real things that happen in street fights. So it's just all something to consider, guys. I know it's a ramble, but so right here, my daughter's got side control. I'm gonna explain to her how to escape side control. So I learned this from Hicks and Gracie seminar on YouTube. There's a Hawaii seminar. I think it's from like the early 90s or so, maybe 80s. This technique is huge. I'm just reaching my arm this way, and it's positioning her head closer and closer to my head, so she's not in side control, and I'm able to go sideways here. Now, the more she pushes into me, the more I can move myself away from her by using that arm technique. There we go. Grab the head, grab the arm, prevent punches. Jiu-jitsu is not the kind of thing that you can just learn or understand. You have to immerse yourself into it to learn it and understand it. You have to fail everything to understand how to do everything wrong so that you know what not to do. And then you can start learning what to do, and learning defense, escapes, counters, and eventually you'll be able to apply submissions, positional control, and striking to your adversary, basically. Right here, okay, so she's got around my head here. I'm controlling her, and this is gonna allow her, this frame she has, to keep my headline off of her body, and it's gonna align. She's gonna move me as she moves, and our heads are gonna align, and I'm not gonna have the pressure I had before. She's using her foot on the mat, so I can't push her back in, and then her right leg, the shin, across my hips. That prevents me from getting my hip to her hip and flattening her back out. Gracie is just on the mats. I need to get her a gi. Look at her, she's just, what are you guys doing? I got some steaks. Today's Valentine's Day. I uploaded a little short. I have a bigger video I could make. Let me know the next food video you guys want to see. Do you want to see I have way more than this that I get to upload, but I'll give you guys two choices. I've been wanting to upload these videos, and I took one of them yesterday. Red lobster shrimp feast, all you can eat, the whole experience there. Or my last trip to Texas Roadhouse. That was really good. I do like the Texas Roadhouse steaks. I feel like it's a pretty good deal for the amount you get and stuff. I like to get a 12-ounce Fort Worth ribeye there. That's what I got. I'll post it in another video. I like to get that with the house salad and mashed potatoes and butter. I ordered my steak rare there. Some people don't like rare steak. I love rare steak, but I also enjoy medium rare. So I feel whenever I order, I can make a perfect steak at home in my sous vide and my cast irons, and I have a smoker and I have a barbecue grill. Like, I can make a good steak. Anyways, I order it rare at restaurants every time, because a lot of times they're gonna go past rare, but they're never gonna go past medium rare if you order rare. So when you order medium rare, a lot of times they'll just fuck it up and it'll be medium, and then you gotta say something. But I don't have anxiety to say something to the staff if I order a rare steak and it comes medium rare, I'm fine. I won't even say anything. But if it comes medium well or anything above that, I'm like, you guys, what the heck? I ordered rare. So it's just something. But yeah, if you haven't ate a rare steak, give it a shot. I started eating rare steaks, which is just 130 internal temperature Fahrenheit. It's like, it's so good though. It's just, you gotta let it rest. And the trick is to salt your meat for at least a few hours, uncovered. Don't cover it with anything in the refrigerator. Heavy salt, uncovered in the refrigerator, and then when you go to cook your steak, however you like to cook it, it'll be extremely tender. No chewiness, especially if you like your steak rare, not chewy at all. This video has to be getting close to done, because I just realized my timer that I had set, it has to have been close to, it's only 49 minutes, so I'm guessing I have like 10 more minutes on here. Maybe not. The water sound, if you guys can hear that in the background, is just running some water over the steaks I took out. It was a 2-pack of ribeyes, boneless, and I cut them. I buy the prime rib, and then, or the rib roast, whatever. I don't need to try to buy. I look and see, you know, my favorite is ribeyes, you know, but I'll get any. My favorite is steaks, obviously beef. But I'll get any quality because I can cook it good enough, you know. But so whatever's the cheapest and stuff. Sometimes if you look for the quality though, you'll find it for really cheap. You just gotta know what to look for, especially with the ribeye steak. You want the center filet mignon piece to be small. You don't want it big. And then just a big rib cap. That's what you want. You get all the flavor. I'll buy chuck steaks, chuck roast. I always buy the roast and then cut my own 1-inch steaks. Vacuum seal each one individually, and then it doesn't really freezer burn. You can keep it easily for a year or longer. Honestly, I'm one of those people that, I mean, a steak in the freezer, vac sealed 2-3 years, I'll still eat it, no problem. I don't have any problem with that. So now we're gonna roll a little bit. Yep, see, testing her base, pushing against her. See, I don't want her to just, when I move my hands, I don't want her to just fall into me. So I'm gonna put her in a headlock right here, I think. Oh. Now I go for a little standing knee bar self-defense. So if someone's trying to pick you up and throw you on your head, you can put all your you can put your weight on the mat and then grab their leg in between your legs. You want to grab all the way down on the bottom of the mat. So she gets a takedown right here. Now she got hip pressure on my legs. I'm telling her to keep my arm across her chest by gluing her chest. I don't want to get back to my guard. That's a nice way to keep people from turning back into you. Their arm can't go back under you if you pin your chest nice and tight. Gracie, what are you doing? Get off the mats. Get your dirty nails off the mats, Gracie. All right, I'm gonna explain to her how to get a quick choke from when someone has a collar from back control. It's one of my favorite ones. A lot of people just will wrench this on people, and it just doesn't work, because it's the same concept with the cross collar choke. I don't know what it is, but there's few things where it's just, even the instructionals from the source, the best people you could imagine teaching it, Roger Gracie teaching these chokes, they still leave out some details, and it just blows me away. So this is a good way how to feed the collar, nice little trick. A lot of people don't know this. You just loosen one, pull, slightly loosen the other hand, and move it up. That way they can't get your hand off of there. Now you'll see when I turn my hand, this essentially turns into a, I don't want to say 2-finger grip, but you're not going to grab with anything but your thumb and like your pointer finger on the hand around the neck. Yeah, that's a good choke. It's fun. Like, you pretend you're like severing the head, but it closes everything up. If you do that choke wrong and have the grip wrong, though, I could see why people give up on it, because the person just slips their head out once they know how to defend it. But if you know how to connect your wrist to their neck and throat, yeah. She has a really good single leg. So you'll see here, this is something she's really good at, is her wrestling. Still have years of work on it, but okay, so she has really good pressure right here. She's gonna try to clear the leg. She's keeping all my stuff just pinned, climbing up, not leaving any space. She's staying really close. Now it looks like I'm gonna try to start getting my guard back. She does a good job trying to put weight down so I can't get this electric chair here. Good base. She stands up a little. She's trying real hard not to go to her back. I grab both of her legs and she's still trying not to go down. She's not just giving it up. And I'm taking away all of her base, and then she's trying to get a front choke. Now right here, I explained to her a Von Flew choke. When someone is trying to get a choke or a guillotine or a front headlock and you pass to side control, they don't let go of the headlock or the front headlock, whatever you want to call it, the guillotine. It's the easiest choke to get. People don't see it coming if they don't realize it's a choke. It is so easy to apply. Anybody can do it. You just squeeze your hands together. When they keep that, they give you the underhook when they keep that headlock and you just go around their head. It is an extremely easy choke to do. And so many people will clear the headlock and not apply the choke. And it's like, dude, the fight could have been over. The round could have been over right there. I see it in MMA all the time. Some people talking to us off mat, probably mom. Damn, she has a good, look how she stood up from that. I should be able to knock her down, no problem. But she's grabbing me and there we go. I start to get her down. Look at her base. That was good. See how she did that? Just kept putting my head down because my hand was holding her legs, which means I wasn't, if I didn't let go on base with that, that's exactly what would have happened. That's what happened. She took me down. Right here, she's using that leg. She's trying real hard to face me. Not get her back taken. See, I've instilled in her the importance of pinning. So she focuses her weight and getting heavy. And that really shuts down the person on the bottom. The weird thing about jiu-jitsu is, you know, it's about strategy. So like what's cool about jiu-jitsu is through strategy, you can beat someone who's actually better than you. All you have to do is get them in the one position that you're able to control them in. So if you know, oh, this person can beat me no problem, they're beating me, but if I can take them down, I know I can pass their guard. They're not good from the guard, you know, and I can beat them. It's how you need to think. You have to figure out how you can prevail over your opponent. My favorite guard pass. Which this is the other one I want to make an exclusive video on. I'll stand up in a second and show her exactly how to do this, but it's the same from the double underpass. A lot of people do that. They just use all strength once they get double unders on the legs to pass, and you'll see they'll throw the person left, they'll throw them right and try to throw them, but the person just keeps recovering their guard. You're supposed to do it a specific way, and the only people I've seen do it correctly, like on video, is Helson Gracie the most, and Hickson Gracie. So here, I'm gonna explain to her the importance of posture, where to put my hands, how to weave them in. I'm gonna pinch her legs between my thighs and my elbows. That makes it so she can't move her hips. Once I have control, also the other thing to stress is posture. That can't be stressed enough. You gotta look up with your eyes first. You see right away, I look up with my eyes, my head starts to go up. Then my hips come forward, and from my knees up to my head, I straighten right there. Now look where her legs are. This is what happens to people. Then all you have to do is swim your hand in. Watch how I do this detail. Swim in. I learned this from progressive jiu-jitsu seminar I attended years ago. Sydney Silva, Hicks and Gracie black belt, also a judo black belt. Really nice guy. He did a seminar at Trevor Burnell's school. And that's who I got my blue belt from, is Trevor Burnell from Progressive Jiu-Jitsu. He owns it in somewhere in Oregon, somewhere by Portland. Can't remember, Mill Plain or something. Anyway, Sydney Silva taught this pass at a seminar. A ton of stuff that I still use to this day. See, even with her trying to go for leg locks, all these things, you sit on the leg. Now watch here. Let's see if I show the detail again. It's important how you melt your hips, and the one foot has to get really, really close. I think I missed explaining it. That's okay, though. I'll do an exclusive video. The one foot, you got to commit here too, because you're going to feel like the guy's going to sweep you from the bottom. But the one foot is going to walk itself all the way to the person on the bottom. It's going to walk all the way to their butt. So she stands up right there. There. Hands underneath. And that left foot, see how she has that so close to my hips? That's how you melt the hips, right there. Like that. I don't know what people try to force this pass with their arms. It's crazy. Oh, my doggo needs to go potty. Just working right here, moving around a bunch, trying to get, it's just the more you learn how to float on top of someone, there's two different things you have to know though, complete pinning pressure and control, but then you also have to be able to float on top of them where you almost apply no pressure, you let them move and then reapply pressure when needed. The way that works is you stay a step ahead of them. Which you're able to do if you're on top and you don't happen to make a mistake. You can stay ahead of the person the whole time. One move ahead kind of thing. What's she doing? Oh, I hate when she does that. Yeah. Well, she comes in sometimes and she has grass and mud on her feet. Okay. I know. So she wants to, look at this. She's gonna move the hand, go for the clinch, and I start to see if I can flip her over here. Okay, yeah, so I'm gonna show her, don't forget your headlock escape. I'm gonna punch, and then she's gonna grab. On this spot too, you don't grab an underhook, you grab over the elbow. If you grab under and grab the wrist, try that. Anybody try that, it's actually wrong. You can do that, it'll work, blah, blah, blah. But with tell your opponent to really try to punch you in the face. They can still punch you really easily. It's if you grab over the elbow, it's almost impossible for them to move their arm back when you pin it to the body. When you grab on the wrist, you're just going to be holding the hand that they're punching you in the face with. It doesn't stop the punch. So I see black belts all the time teach the move wrong. Black belts directly under Hicks and Gracie teach the move wrong. And I'll be honest, it's frustrating. I'm not perfect, but I just, some of these, this is how technique gets watered down over the years. And then people put out, oh, that's such a great, they show everything great. But no, you got to be able to say, to see, oh, well, they're doing that move a little wrong. There's a better way to do it. And you just got to be open-minded. If someone shows me something, oh, do it this way, actually. And I feel that it is better, you know, but I will change it and do it that way and experiment and find out if it's truly better. Same thing with grabbing an arm lock. When you're finishing an arm lock, sometimes people wrap over the wrist and then grab with their hand that's over the person's wrist. They'll grab up at their lapel or their shoulder. My brother showed me years ago, if you grab over their wrist, but you keep your arm, your elbow tight to your body, and then your arm goes straight across your own body, not up and onto your shoulder, you could hold the person's wrist with one hand. Like, it is such a strong grip. Same thing with a single leg takedown. You can get that same grip across your belly to your hip. It is really hard to get your arm or leg back when someone does that. When I grab up to my lapel, like a lot of people teach it, people can rip their hand out even when I have really strong control. They can rip it out eventually, you know? Anyways, though, the other way, they can't. It works so much more effectively. Here comes the doggo. Okay. Gracie, get. Go lay down, girl. Go lay down. Well, it was a long video. I hope it's over soon, because I know those steaks are probably just thawed out all the way. See, and I'm grabbing her arm to the lapel grip. See, that's a good, I'll explain the one-handed grip on how to finish. A couple pops on the elbow just to teach a lesson. I'm just showing her. It's funny because it's just part of jiu-jitsu. It's like the old schoolness of jiu-jitsu, but where you just, you know, I mean, we came up in the days where people went so hard and and just, it was rough. Now, when you go to a jiu-jitsu gym, it's like everybody's like, honestly, dude, they're just so scared. Just, oh my God, how dare you like rub the lapel across my face? Like, it's crazy to me. I just want her to learn, you know, how to do the jiu-jitsu tough, you know, for self-defense. Boom, that was smooth. Look at that. Now I'm gonna come up. This is sick. She has good control. Boom. Got it. So always good sportsmanship. Help your white belt up and then throw them back down. Ooh, look at that defense she had. That's good, because in a street fight, she would have hit her butt on the ground a little bit, her hips, but not her head. All right, that's how you do it. Awesome. All right, I hope you guys enjoyed. If you want, oh, it's over.